I've been having a great time. It's a very lovely atmosphere here, and everyone who's arrived have been, you know, really wonderful and lovely. No nutcases, which is always good. And everyone's been absolutely brilliant, and there's a great buzz here. I mean, it's quite an extraordinary event. I've never done one before, so it's a big first for me.
Done one before. What made you want to be a part of this one today?
Well, I think it's probably because no one's ever asked me. But it's a big event, and when you see all the other people are here, and it's Nate, I'm with David next door to me here, and all other people that I've worked with on the show. So meeting up with them again is great, and so it's a social affair for us too. Katie Manning, who I worked with on Doctor Who, actually I didn't work with her on Doctor Who. That's a lie, and Doctor Who fans will know that's not true, because I worked with Peter Davidson on Doctor Who. But Katie Manning and I were in a play together back in about 1974. We haven't seen each other since that day. And so we've been catching up, because she went out to Australia. She was the assistant to, I can't remember which doctor now. But the fans will know, so you can help me out there.
They'll post comments, I'm sure. Now, I mean, you've been meeting fans. What have they been asking you about the most? What kind of questions have you been getting?
Well, how much I enjoyed my filming on Harry Potter, which was great. I'm saying, you know, it was a very hard job, a tricky job, because I had lots of difficult scenes to do, with sons dying all over the place, that kind of thing. And a lot of people from Hollyoaks, actually, people saying, you know, where's your Hollyoaks photographs? I didn't bring any today. We've got lots of Harry Potter ones, and Doctor Who, of course, and Drop the Donkey. That's been a big... people have been... A lot of fans from that show have come up and said hello, which has been lovely, a show we all love doing, and so we have hardcore fans for that, which was a small audience, but they came back every week, which is always nice, because you know you've got a very high class viewer.
Let's start with Potter. What do you think it is about this world that J.K. Rowling created that's just so magical and has captivated people around the world?
Well, I think it's extraordinary. My wife bought the very first Harry Potter book for my daughter when it came out, thinking, oh, this will be interesting. And it's extraordinary. I mean, she's 21 now, and it's just like amazing how it's taken off. And but I think it's, what is it? I don't know. I think it's got an awful lot of heart, and it's very generous. And I think that's perhaps missing in a lot of things. You know, you go and watch stuff, and you think, yeah, it was good, or it was this, or that, but it doesn't embrace you in the same way or that these stories do. And I think people feel they're part of a family, they're part of a, you know, a tradition, they're part of, you know, something really special, and that's why they keep coming back to it again and again.
Speaking of family, your son has gone on to become one of the leading male actors on the planet. Can you talk a little bit about working with Rob quite early in his career?
Robert Pattinson. I mean, extraordinary. What a lovely boy, you know. And who would have known he was going to go on to do such great things? I mean, extremely good looking. Of course, that's why I was cast, because they needed to find someone who was a match, a believable father. And I think they did a pretty good job there.
Could you tell at that early stage that there was just something special about it?
Yes, absolutely, you could. I mean, all the girls were kind of just falling over themselves, you know, were just drooping whenever he walked by. And that's always a good indicator, I think. I've never had that happen to me, strangely. I don't know, I can't think quite why. People are fearful of me because I might murder them. But Robert had this, you know, he has this wonderful charm and very easy grace about him, which I think, you know, he conveys, is conveyed to the screen, you know. And he's a very special boy. I had great, fun memories of working with him. He's a lovely, lovely, lovely lad.
He's a lovely lad, but you had some very, very difficult scenes with him emotionally. I mean, can you talk a little bit about how you worked together? Bringing one of the saddest moments in the Potter franchise to life.
Yeah, I think it was a big moment. It's funny, I remember director Mr. Newell saying, I don't know how you're going to do this, but you've got to do it. And so I just went out and did it, and bizarrely, working with David Bradley, who played Filch in the show, he was in that scene with me, and he just reminded me this morning, he said, God, you know, we did it like over 2 days, and I don't know how many takes we had to do it. So what you don't realise is that every time I had to run down and find the dead body, it was like there were quite a few takes of that, endless takes, and every time, you know, Michael Gambon was looking at me kind of going, come on, on your feet, do it again, do it again.
And it's my all, son.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, but they're all laughing because I was really having to go through the mill each time I did it. To try and, because you didn't know which take they were going to go with or from what angle or, and sometimes you do it and you think that's a great take, but they hadn't got the eyes or they hadn't got, you know, this moment. So there's an awful lot of effort goes into shooting a tiny sequence like that. But hopefully it pays off in the end and it makes the point in the film.
Beyond that particular sequence, which I think is clearly stuck in fans' mind, do you have a particular favourite moment from the Potter series? I mean, just in general in the film you were involved with?
I remember going in one day and someone said, you're going to be cycling through the air and we're just going to do a bit of a tryout. That was just an extraordinary moment. We all had to get hoisted up by these men. There were like about 15 of them from Kirby's just pulling ropes to get the counterweights going to get us up. And of course the kids, as I call them, Daniel, they're just fantastic at flying because they've been doing it for so long. I mean, they could go solo and do backflips and stuff. We were all just rather fearful coming down from 100 foot, you know, to do that sequence where we arrive at the port to get the port key and that bit there. That was fantastic. And the other bit that fascinated me was when we had to climb the hill, which was done inside. And it was against CGI. We'd done some outside filming of the hill, and they had to match us coming to the top of the hill, and they put every blade of grass by hand into the hill. So every time we walked over it, we would stop, and it would take like an hour and a half to reset these blades of grass. So when you watch that sequence in the film, think of those poor prop boys going, oh no, they've stepped on too many. And that was the extraordinary nature of the making of the film, was that they could go to those lengths and take that time and that detail, which is why they're so rich and so brilliant.
You talk quite a lot about Robert, I mean, a magnificent young actor. Can you talk a little bit about working with Daniel, Rupert and Emma? I mean, again, just some of the bright lights of the British film.
They were all just fantastic. I mean, you don't know what you're going to find when you go out to work with people. You think, well, I don't know, well, they'll be like child actors and maybe they'll be a bit, you know, stuffy or spoilt or something. But they were all just pure joy to work with. And all such lovely people, you know, that you'd want to spend, you know, more time with them. I had a very brief time with them. And Daniel came to see me in a play I was in, which I was very thrilled about. And the two kids who were in the play, was after the first night and he came to see it, and we went downstairs with the two kids who were in the play, and it was their first acting job, and they came to us and they went, my God, Daniel Radcliffe's here. Why is Daniel Radcliffe? I don't know why he's here. He said, no, I saw you were in the play and I thought I'd come and see it. He loved their performances, was able to speak to them, because it, you know, meant a huge amount to them, and it was just a great moment. You know, it was wonderful. What a nice boy.
Wonderful that sense of family on set's kind of continued, clearly. I mean, as have you been in touch with Robert at all? I mean, do you still give him some fatherly advice sometimes?
No, I haven't spoke to him since. He's gone off. He's far too grand now to always speak to his aged film father. But I'm hoping that he might get me a job in one of his movies. So if he sees this, you know, could work together again, I think.
You're biased because you played his dad, but are you a Twilight fan?
Yeah, obviously, yeah. I watch them endlessly.
I mean, we've talked a lot about Potter, but like you say, people have been talking to you about all sorts of things today. I mean, Doctor Who, can you talk a little bit about being involved in just a landmark of British science fiction?
Well, Doctor Who was amazing because I'd watched it since the very first day that it came out in black and white. I remember sitting on the sofa at home when I was a little boy, going, oh my gosh, this is something very scary and strange about this. Nothing had been on television like it before. It's quite hard to explain. We're kind of used to all these kind of sci-fi things now. But then they were genuinely, I think, quite frightening because they were asking you to think about things that we hadn't been asked to think about as children before. And when those school teachers went into that phone box and met this grumpy old man, it was William Hartnell, was the very first Doctor Who, it was a scary, scary thing. And yeah, and I was completely hooked by it. So when I actually had to go and be, you know, well, I was actually chosen to be in Doctor Who, it was a great privilege. And I remember rehearsing the scenes in the rehearsal room on going into the TARDIS, which I had a kind of mock-up of. And obviously it had been there for a few years. And the control panel was all laid out. As I looked down, as we were saying our lines, someone had written short spin, Woolens only, hot wash. against the control panel, which I thought was very funny. Some witty moment from some actor, or rather bored in rehearsals, had scribbled those things in. But yeah, it was a great film. When we actually got to do the actual filming on the TARDIS, you think, my God, you know, I'm on the TARDIS here. I mean, there's not many people can say that. You know, I've walked out. It was a great privilege. Yeah.
Clearly been a Who fan from the very beginning. Yeah. Are you a fan of the current series? I mean, what do you think of Matt Smith?
Yeah, oh, it's fantastic. It's wonderful. I mean, I've followed it all the way along. And I then got to work with Peter Davison later on, and we've worked on a lot of things together. And yeah, I still watch it now. And I think, you know, it's quality, you know, science fiction drama. It's, you know, there's not a lot else out there on television that, you know, to compare with it. So it does really, really well. And it's a great show still. It's amazing. It's held up after all these years.
Yeah. Talking about great shows that have stood the test of time, you mentioned before, obviously, Drop the Dead Donkey. A lot of people, still so much affection out there for that. I mean, what do you think has given that series that enduring affection with fans?
Well, I think, again, that was kind of I think it was brilliantly written, and I think it was it was a show that was character-based, so people got to know the characters and they got to like them. And we all enjoyed doing it so much. So again, you hope that transfers to the screen, that we all had such a great time, and we've still remained very close friends, all of us, ever since. I think we're about to do something for Channel 4, looking back at their comedy programs over the years, and everyone, you know, is coming in to sort of give a shout out for the show, because we still love it. I mean, I think it's a long time ago now, so we've finished, but 12 years or more, maybe 15 years, I don't know, I can't remember now. Yeah, it's still very dear to our hearts, and it's something that we, you know, we really, really enjoy doing. So it's great when people come and say, oh, I wish that was still on. We think, yeah, we do too, actually. So does my bank manager.
You mentioned their fans obviously wish the show was still on. You guys as a cast are still very close and still have a lot of affection for it. Is there an appetite there to maybe bring it back at some point?
I think there have been moments when people have tried to revive it, and I think everybody would have come back if they'd, you know, said, but I mean, some of us are getting on a bit now. And I don't know. I mean, there's no reason why not. I mean, David Swift, who played the old newsreader, he just turned 80. And I worked out that when I came into the show, he was the same age as I am now, which is kind of an odd thing. That because at the time I thought, oh my gosh, he's like, how nice, this very elderly actor has got this lovely job. That'd be rather nice, wouldn't you? Otherwise he would be retired. And I didn't realise, of course, that, you know, at 61 I would still be doing it, and still intend to continue doing it for a long time to come.
Of which, have you got anything in particular coming up at the moment?
Well, yes, I think there is a rumour that I may be going back into Hollyoaks. I think that's on the cards. I've been working recently on Raymond Briggs's Father Christmas, which I'm hoping we might do at Christmas time at the Hammersmith Lyric. That's never been done before on stage. Made a great cartoon, obviously. The Snowman's been done, but Father Christmas hasn't. So for Father Christmas, Raymond Briggs fans out there, hopefully we'll get that together. And there's lots of other bits and pieces around in the pipeline, but to wait and see what pans out.
Hollyoaks fans will be delighted at the news you may be coming back. I mean, are there any dates for that?
It hasn't been finalised yet, but they've been repeating little bit moments from the show and to torment Mercedes' character with, I noticed. So I think there's a sort of a feeling perhaps he might somehow make another appearance. I think that's on the cards.
You mentioned that clearly fans have been talking to you about Hollyoaks. It's very rapidly sort of established itself as just another fixture of the British soap scene. I mean, what do you think it is about Hollyoaks that fans latched onto so quickly?
Well, I think that it's a young teen soap drama, isn't it? And I think that they like that. And I think they also like to see the older characters as well messing up their lives, and as older, you know, parents do. We're all, you know, we say one thing and do another. And I think that's good. I think, in a way, there's not a lot of TV drama around for that age group. And it's possibly not particularly well served. And so Hollyoaks, you know, fills a much-needed gap, I think. And it's a hard audience to get right, you know, to get the stuff right for. I think, you know, it's a hard call for the scriptwriters to get, you know, to just not to be too condescending and not to be too, you know, or to be too hip or too whatever, and to tell good stories every week, you know, that people want to are latched into. That's quite hardcore. It's a lot of television every week to make, and to make it keep the standard up is quite difficult.
Conscious, I have to let you get back to fans today, but for all of the fans who couldn't be here, especially Potter fans, is there anything you'd like to say to them?
Keep the force. That's what I'd say, yes, absolutely. No, that's Star Trek. Well, yes, keep watching the movies so that I get my repeat fees on DVD. And thank you very much for watching.